It's actually made up of a few neurologists, some economists, and some people who just focus on electronic devices. So I bring the data and computational input to that team so that we look around the world for talent. Now, in that context, you know, so we work on epilepsy. And I'm sure you guys are familiar with epilepsy as a disease, right? Like in Tamil, we call it kakaolip or something like that. It's probably. Now, people get seizures. When people get seizures, you know, it's a very debilitating thing. They might fall down and hurt themselves. Like, let's say if somebody is cooking, if a person is epileptic and when they're cooking, if they get seizure, they might fall on hot content, right? So one of the challenges we have was, can we predict epileptic seizures? Can we predict that about 15 minutes before it happens, right? So we work on things like that. So that is the question. So let's say for epilepsy, my question is, can we predict seizures that happen within 15 minutes? So then, that's like any other question, right? In data science, what do you do next? Look at all the possible data that you can get in this context. So let's say I'm looking at epileptic seizures. If the only data I had is what medicine the person took over a period of, what they bought over a period of time, maybe that information is not sufficient. Maybe I want some real-time data. Maybe I want their heartbeat every minute or every second if I want to make a prediction. So the next thing, once you have a question, what you look for is to see if you have right kind of data. And when you collect all this data together, we apply algorithms, various algorithms. You pick algorithms from a bag. For various kinds of problems, you have various sets of algorithms. You apply the right set of algorithm, or if it's not sufficient, you invent an algorithm. Then the most critical part, the most critical part for me, is to interpret it, right? To see whether it can be realized. Can you actually tap once more? Yeah. So, in general, actually, this is a very fine learning point, a delineating point. Even in the panel, we had a person from banking, a person from insurance. So data science is not really a new field. In fact, insurance companies have been using data science for 200, 300 years, right? The big difference between the way data science is done today versus how companies have been doing in the past is, in the past, people have always been sampling. Like if an insurance company wanted to go and make an analysis 100 years ago, 50 years ago, they would take a small sample of population and use traditional statistical methods to do the analysis. But today, because of the massive computing power and the data acquisition power we have, sampling be done. We don't sample anymore as much as possible. We collect all the data. In essence, we collect information from a population, an entire population. We learn from that, and we apply it to an individual. Right? Does it make sense? So we're not sampling as we used to anymore. That's the fine line. That's where companies change. Like when Google looks at things, they don't sample people. They look at the entire population. One of the advantages of that approach is a lot of traditional statistical techniques get washed away. Because the foundation of statistics as such is to come up with accurate estimates based on samples. Now, if you're not dealing with samples instead of the entire data set, a lot of the things go away. And that is the power of data science. Right? So this is how I look at things, like four essential elements of data science, right? Question, data, algorithms, and results. Now let's see how this applies in pharmaceuticals in particular, but healthcare in general. Next one. All right. So let's briefly walk through what a typical pharmaceutical company does. Now, this is not really specific to pharmaceuticals. You can think about this as a phone manufacturer or any toy manufacturer. They all typically go through these cycles, right? So pharmaceuticals, in case if somebody are not aware, are the companies that manufacture drugs, medicines for injections, and things like that. Now, so what do they do? Number one, they make drugs. Now, that is a very, very complex process. Like, you have hardcore scientists over there. my company, which is Netzero, one of the smaller pharmas, probably have around 500 plus scientists, like pretty much PhDs, 20 plus years working on these things, right? So that's a very complex process, uses extreme intense data manipulations, and that is well taken care of. Because that's, I would say, a mature science, right? Okay, you make your drug, what do you do next? You got to sell it, right? Like any product, you make the iPhone, what do you want? You got to sell it. Most of these things, especially in Western countries, you don't sell directly to patients. You sell to intermediate agencies, like pharmacies, like governments, right? But just selling alone is not sufficient, because these are complex things. You have to promote it. And you can't advertise it like Boost or something on the TV, right? You have to advertise it to the right people. In this case, it is doctors. So we educate the doctors, right? So that's how the promotion cycle. And finally, the product reaches the consumer, which is the patient in this case. Now, steps 1, 2, 3, 4, you can translate to any company, right? Think about, give me an example, like anything, like iPhone or watch or something like that. They make it, they sell it, they promote it, the consumers use it. But with healthcare and with pharmaceuticals, one of the biggest challenges and the biggest opportunity is, what happens next? So if your phone is not working well, how does your phone manufacturer get to know about it? You can call their customer support and complain, or go to Facebook and write crappy things about them, right? They get to know about those things very easily. In other words, there is a direct channel of communication between patient and company, right? Now, think about the healthcare system. You go to a doctor, your doctor gives you some medication. First of all, do you know who even manufactures those medicines? Most of us don't have a clue who manufactures those things. The patent is probably held by somebody in South Africa, it is manufactured in China, it's distributed somewhere, and nobody knows, right? And if something is wrong, what is the process? Like, let's say a doctor in Pilamere prescribes a medicine that's bad, that goes bad. The check. How do you think, and when do you think the company gets to know about that? It's very, very unlikely the first time the person gets a failed response in that incident. The first time, let's say somebody dies out of it. Nobody's going to die. No, notice, right? Care. Probably a lot of people will have to suffer, right? And with a lot of medications, it's not an instantaneous thing. Like you might take a cholesterol drug that you're supposed to take for 5 years. So how would you know when it goes back? This loop, the feedback loop from what happens to patients with companies literally does not exist in pharmaceutical industry. They rely on a feedback mechanism that actually goes back all the way. Doctors, if they notice some abnormal patterns, they write journals, they publish papers. And the pharmaceutical companies or other manufacturers read about these things in the journals. And then discover. It's a shame, really, in the industry, right? With so much computing technology, and one of the biggest problems is actually, I have a hard time talking to young people about pharmaceutical industry. Because you're all in your pink of health, you guys have no interest, right, about healthcare, pharmacy. You just don't want to visit hospitals, right? If I ask a career option, a lot of you will say Googles, Facebooks, I want to send better pictures, things like that. But the reality is, there's so much need in this industry, you know? And that is not satisfied. And part of the reason why it is not done is, I will give a few reasons. Number one reason why this is not allowed is regulatory. Pretty much every government in the world does not allow it. The government does not want manufacturer to know anything about this individual. So we actually buy some data about individuals, but it's all completely scrubbed, so that we will not know any personal information about them. So, the second one is lack of data. In the last 15 years, the data footprint has, this ecosystem has grown so much, we just take many things for granted. Like we take when you bring up your phone, you expect your location to be there. You expect pretty much all these things for granted. But when it comes to healthcare ecosystem, next slide. The ways, how can the information go back? Just think about it. When you go to a doctor, what are the kinds of information you get? The doctor comes up with some prescription or something like that. They might take an x-ray. They might ask you to do some additional tests. So all these information pretty much resides in islands, right? The power of data science, as we saw earlier, is collecting information from the population and learning from that. That means a doctor, when will data science be effective in a healthcare environment? Only when we can collect the data from all the patients, from all the population, and put them all together, right? But there is really no infrastructure to allow that. And that area has been actively, for various reasons, like privacy and security, intentionally, you know, it has been prevented. Now, so let's go to the next slide. So now, a company like mine, a pharmacy, right? Some of the fundamental questions we have is these things, these four things. Okay, great, we are manufacturing drugs and we are giving it. Are people taking the right drugs for the right conditions, right? We might have a great drug, but you might have some other condition which might make it ineffective or dangerous. Now, again, to be fair, the pharmaceutical companies do a lot of trials before a drug is released in the market. It's an extensive process. By the time a first drug is conceived in the mind of a person as a potential solution, by the time it hits the market, it's usually about 10 years, right? But still, at the best case, it could be tried on about 500 to 1,000 people, right? There's no substitute for test. I mean, there's so many variations, right? And most of these drugs really are, the R&D is done in Western world, and they get distributed throughout the world. They try to accommodate as much as possible, but still, there are variabilities that are about to be discovered. So, we are always interested in this question. Is the drug right? Is the dosage right? Are we giving the right dose? Are we giving too much? Are we getting too little? Because initially when it's large, it is by crude metrics, usually a proportion of body weight, right? And by gender, by age, and things like that. So we keep asking these questions. The second one is, are they effective? Is it really working? And the other side of that is, are there any side effects, right? Anything immediate, long term? And one fundamental question, in fact, healthcare industry is so primitive, you would not even think about this as a problem. By adherence, I mean people taking the right amount of medication at the right time. You wouldn't think that's a problem, right? Yeah, you give medicine, you take it. But if you look for chronic conditions like diabetes or obesity or many other conditions, people have to take drugs in a very particular sequence, right? And it's not always possible. Now, there will usually be some tolerance, but we don't know, right? And add on top of that, the population distribution, the children population, right? How do you ensure the kids take the medication? And then the elderly, the vast majority of them elderly, how do you ensure that they take it properly? So this is a huge issue. And even today, people are thinking about diaries. A diary is the best solution. A paper diary is the best solution. And people are trying to bring up with apps, mobile apps, like fancy apps. I have probably come across 20, 30 apps, right? And so whenever such a fancy company comes up, we go investigate and we look at the user base. It almost always has a standard pattern. The moment app is launched, you'll see a huge spike in usage. Then about 2-3 months down, it's almost down. That tells me just one story. It's not effective. The tool is not effective to manage, right? The problem is, anytime you ask people to enter any extra information about something, you are introducing an opportunity to make mistakes, right? People can be lazy. They'll take the medicine, but opening up the phone, taking up the phone, bringing it together, and entering a form saying, I took 100 milligrams of this medicine, or checking a box. It's actually a painful process. It's disruptive, right? But think about it. If people are not adhering to the medicine, like a pharmaceutical company says, it's a big problem. We might take the best drug, but people are not taking it effectively. It's a big problem, right? So, fortunately, pharmaceutical companies are loaded with cash. Money is not a problem. In fact, a funny joke, this really happened. So my company, four average people in my company wanted to meet with the top guy in Amazon, right? Whose time was so precious, he said, I have only 2 hours on this particular day in San Francisco. If you guys want, come and meet me, right? No problem. Our guys just get on a plane, we always fly first class, just go there, stay in the best hotel, because San Francisco is an expensive city. You stay in the, so we rent the hotel right in the middle, we are in the private room, and we are waiting for 3 hours. The guy couldn't come, because Amazon policy does not allow such expensive hotels. So he had to stay 4 hours away, or 2 hours away, come back, right? So the companies, healthcare companies have money, but they don't have opportunity. Like, these are fundamental problems. So if we want to apply data science to these things, where do we start? So we know our questions. These are our hypotheses. We know our questions, right? Do you remember the cycle? Second step is what? If you know your question, what is the second step? Data, right? So that's where, like, I'm probably getting near my time, so can you go to? So basically, this is my job, you know, cutting up these things. But I'll just give you a snapshot of the kind of data sets we are exploring, right? So on the top of these things is what's getting more and more prevalent, the electronic medical record and billing. So what we mean by that is when you go to a doctor's office, pretty much everything that happens in terms of interaction, the patient came in, the patient's body temperature this time was this, the body weight was this, the primary diagnosis was something, and I did all these procedures, I recommended these medications. So all these things are data, footprint, right? Which typically a doctor is encouraged to enter into a system that becomes electronic medical record. That becomes a system. Now, again, in today's standard, pretty much every hospital has its own isolated island of electronic medical record. So it's useful, like if I want a population of epileptic people who had severe seizures, and if I go to a large hospital, I might get 2,000 people. Another hospital might give me 5,000 people. Whereas if Google wants to run an experience, an experiment, it has all 500 million people on it, right? Data available with them to readily use. Whereas, because of the isolated nature of these data sets, these are not available anymore. In fact, that is where I think is a big opportunity. And with many fields, we see a huge chasm between the Western world and the Eastern world, right? Whereas when it comes to fields like electronic medical record, the gap is about 3 years. Like, we've been trying to buy a consolidated electronic medical record of as many people as we can. We can't get data for more than 3 years. That's how recent it is. Now, think about lab data, right? So this kind of data is primarily text data, the electronic medical record and other things. If you think about lab data, it's just your imagination. You have all kind of media over here. Your x-rays are images, your EKGs, or your ultrasonics are actually sound data, and EKGs are other time series data. So you have various streams coming in. Like I said earlier, every machine in a hospital is generating some kind of data, and there's a potential to get it together. Now come modern apps, like the medicine adherence app, that's the simplest thing I told you, but there are many other apps. There is an app for Parkinson's disease. Are you guys familiar with Parkinson's disease? It's when people start developing shakes and other things. We work on that. A company has come up with a very simple app. All it asks is, ask the person to launch the app, hold the phone, and do some simple things as walk 10 steps, turn around, right? And it shows some game-like things. Touch here. But that's precious data to understand a disease, right? So many such things are coming up, and that's your data from your apps. Genetics, a huge field, right? I don't even have to talk about it. Like, now pretty much the cost of analyzing an individual human gene has come down to an affordable level where, I mean, it's still not free. Like, it's not like you can go and walk in and do it. But still, if a patient has, let's say, cancer, it's affordable to analyze their gene and come up with a medicine that's very specific. It's not like finding the best medicine for what works for a patient. It's about figuring out what will work best for an individual patient, right? So genetics can help enable this. Then, a slew of things are coming out. Your devices. Pretty much you can think of any condition around your body. People are working on coming up with devices. Simple things, your Fitbit can measure a heart rate, right? Now people are working on oximetry and anything like heart rate and sweat conductance and things like that. And this is an area where I found a very interesting thing. So I work closely with a couple of universities. Georgia Tech is one of them. So I came to know that Georgia Tech is one of the well-known universities, out there. They're putting up a 20-plus story building just for integrated healthcare and data science. A 20-story building. I was shocked. What the heck are they doing? And then I came to know that they're actually bringing in all engineering disciplines within their realm to be cohabitant. Like, you're talking about electronics, mechanical, computational science, philosophy. All these guys are getting co-located. The reason is, healthcare is not, or data science is not an isolated field anymore. It cuts across, right? I saw a very simple use case that blew my mind away. So a professor is doing a project on how much weight can a soldier carry? So he figured out, some research student had come up with an idea that whenever you walk, there's actually a small cracking sound in your knee. And they correlated with that, like if there is an increase in fatigue, the noise has a distinct signal. So this electronics professor is working on a microphone that will fit on soldiers' clothing so that it will detect the sound. Now he is working with a computer science professor to come up with an algorithm. And they are working with the other data engineering professor team to figure out how you can upload the signals from soldiers around the world through our infrastructure so that they can connect it. So it definitely makes sense to bring them all together, right? So that's what's happening with the devices. Like even a couple of years ago, with the diabetes, the best you can do is do a fingerprint test, right? But today, the small device you see over here, this, when you attach it to your body, it can give your blood sugar every 5 minutes. So that information gets published to a mobile phone. So imagine the potential. So when we saw that device being used for diabetes, we reached out to them and said, hey, guys, you have a fundamental setup. You have a probe that goes into a body and gets some signals, right? And you have an app that communicates and does all these things. Now, can you also listen to something else that's of interest to my company? So you see how things are evolving, right? The big challenge now is you're getting data streams, various velocities, various volumes across the board. If you're talking about, if I want the entire US information for the last 10, 15 years, this data set, it might be about 10 gigabytes. That's you're talking about 200, 300 million people for 10 years, static data. You come to this, right? That could be that much per person. Who knows? Per person per day as we go about. So the challenge in the healthcare industry is how can we bring all these things together? Because if I can in my dream world have all this data integrated, ready, and not just for individual, but for the entire country or the entire world together, then I can answer these questions much more effectively. Right? So this is what the industry is working towards. So really, like, when I saw the potential, my mind blew away. right? Every single thing. I have an algorithm engineer who is just working on one type of signal. That guy is a PhD in signal analysis. All he's doing is taking one signal and working on it. So what we realize is, not just my company, as an industry as a whole, is there's no way we can hire enough data scientists or software engineers to work on. There's no way, absolutely no way. So instead, we're trying to reach out. And that's why teams like mine exist. Reach out around the world, fund them, literally throw money at them, and see if they can come up with something. Because these are life and death things we're talking about. The sooner we can come up with some insights for these things, the better it's for humanity as a whole, right? So, but the challenges are enormous. It's one thing when a Google ad sends a wrong ad to a person, right? It might be somebody might lose 10 cents on the ad. It's an entirely different ballgame when a wrong drug gets prescribed, right? So the level of accuracy and the precision you need in this process is extremely, I don't even have to explain it. So, and the privacy. So, in this context, you think about any issue, it gets exacerbated because of the nature of the industry. You think about security, suddenly, like, if this data goes out, you know, then suddenly his insurance company will decline insurance for me because I have a genetic disposition for something in the future, right? So suddenly, just to go through this, the governments of the world, like simple things like they would not allow data to be stored outside. Like we have this building data, but every time we want somebody to look at it, we have to fly the person to the country to look at it. So, I mean, we don't understand the concerns, but we also understand the enormous potential of data science, right? In an ideal world, if we can get all these data together. But this is the real opportunity I see. And what excites me and what I think will be pertinent for you guys is, this is just starting. The opportunity floodgate is just opening. You know, so if you have passion for life sciences, this is a great opportunity. In fact, in my own case, like I stopped biology in 10th standard, like many of you. Hated it, wanted to be done with it. Computer science was the coolest thing out there when I started my career, right? Did not touch biology for the next 15, 17 years. Then when I started working on healthcare, and I go back all the way, eat back, start from 11th standard textbook, right? Read about it. But luckily, fortunately, you know, nowadays you don't have to go through a college course. I shamelessly admit that I still spend 4 hours a day in YouTube, in office, right? Pretty much anything you want is out there. You can read specifically. If you want to read about a particular lab report, you just go invest some 4 or 8 tons. As you mature in the industry, one of the things you will learn very fast is how to learn new concepts without diving in too deep, right? So it's actually quite easy nowadays with all the information available to get into a field as common and prevalent and new like this. So is that the last slide?